This meeting is being recorded.
Good morning, everyone. This is the Clay Terrace Bible Study from Clay Terrace neighborhood of Carmel, Indiana, north side suburb of Indianapolis. Welcome, whether you live here or zoom into the neighborhood. Again, we're going to study scripture as best we can from diverse points of view and try to understand best what God's clear message is to us. And how we'd apply it, say, in our neighborhood, even today. So that said, we're going to be in Isaiah 9. Pastor Andy Hunt will be leading. And before we do that, though, Pastor Eric Chepkwani will pray for us.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before your presence this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts. You have given us to see another day, O God. We give you thanks. We don't take it for granted that we are here this morning. Mm-hmm. So we thank you for the wonderful gift of life and the promise of this day. Almighty God, we come to you, and there are prayer praises we have. There are many things you've done, healing, protecting, guiding, providing even for our daily needs. We give you thanks, oh God. Now we want to remember those that have different needs this morning, those that have need healing, sickness, those that need provision. Oh Lord, we pray that your hand may provide. And Lord, we also pray for world peace. We pray especially for leaders of world governments. Pray for wisdom, pray for your guidance, so that we may live in peace. Mighty God, we want to commit this study to your hands, that you may speak to us in a very special way this morning. Pray for Brother Andy, of God, that you may use him as a vessel that God you can speak through, and your word can come to life. And we want to give you all the praise and honor when we hear from you. Give us a good time this morning, for we pray, trusting and believing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, again, we'll be in Isaiah 9. We're going to just read the first 7 verses. Holly, you want to lead us off?
Yes. Excuse me. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future he will honor Galilee of the Gentiles by the way of the sea along the Jordan.
Eric, verse 2. Oh, you're on mute, Eric.
The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shined. You have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian.
Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning and will be fuel for fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. What we're going to see in our time together this morning, that Isaiah is taking a pause here. He wants to ensure us that the story of Israel doesn't end with this coming judgment. Eventually, this darkness is going to lift. The anguish of God's people is going to disappear, and the Lord is going to keep his promises by returning Israel to glory. Now, the glory is going to start back up in the northern Israel, the 10 tribes there, where God's contempt struck the people and the land by allowing the Syrian invasion. This is going to come to us in the form of a poem, and it's going to describe different things that we're going to look at this morning. Let's look at the verse 1 quickly here. For there will be gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the later time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. Okay, if you have to go back to tie verse 1 here into the last couple of verses of Isaiah 8, 20 and 22. To the teaching and to the testimony, it will not speak according to this world, according to this word. It is because they have no dawn. Now, remember, this is going to pick up on the fact that they are in darkness. They have no dawn. They will pass through the land greatly distressed and hungry. And when they are hungry, they will be enraged and speak contemptuously against their king and their God and turn their faces upward. And they will look to the earth, but behold distress and darkness and the gloom of anguish, and they will be thrust in to thick darkness. So Isaiah is speaking about a time. Now, something that's really interesting here, he's speaking in the past tense about a future event, okay? Everything looks like it's in the past tense of a future event. He talks about a time of despair. He talks about a time of darkness. He talks about this anguish will ultimately end for Israel. He's talking about this northern region that belonged to the tribes of Zebulun and Naphtali. That's it, Naphtali. That area was first hit by the destructive power of the Assyrians. They kind of swept through the land around the Sea of Galilee. And here he records a time that shows that they were once conquered in three different districts here. You got the Galilee of the Gentiles, Megiddo province down by the river and down by the Valley of Jezreel, the way to the sea. Now, this is down by the Mediterranean from Joppa to Haifa, and along the Jordan. Isaiah speaks of this time that will come to this region that was once glorious, that now is in darkness, but the darkness will be dispelled. A light will return in the form of a child that we'll see a little later, probably about verse 5. And that child will become the king because he will become the Messiah. Look at verse 2 here. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in the land of a deep darkness, on them a light has shone. So again, this goes back and talks about the darkness where they are have no dawn. They have no dawn because they've rejected, even though they don't know that they rejected God, and in rejecting God, they rejected the light of the world, okay? And here we're going to see a reversal that starts to happen here, that is not going to take fully, not going to take place fully until Jesus Christ is arrives as a Messiah. But the people suffer under their ignorance. They're unhappy. They're insecure. But this is a hopeful sign, right? That there's going to be this light. And this light's going to shine through the darkness of their ignorance, through the darkness of their unbelief. And it's later on going to be obvious to us that this light is no other than Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus will teach them later on and fully establish his kingdom, and everyone who will receive him will receive the light. I want you to look at John chapter 3, verses 19 through 21 for a moment. John chapter 3, verses 19 through 21. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. So even in this dark time, they are still going, some of them are still going to reject the light, even though there's a light that's now shining upon them. We look at verse 3. Isaiah assures us here, you have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. Now, he assures them that this darkness is not going to last forever, that there's a light that's coming. That's in verse 2. And now these believers recognize that their nation is going to be multiplied. They're going to increase their population. And there will be a freedom that will come from their oppressors as well, and they will be returned to the land of abundance. Now, again, he's writing in the past tense of a future event. So Isaiah says that the Lord has multiplied the nations, that he's increased their population, and that this they're going to see an abundant harvest, because they're going to see even the weapons of war, I think we see that more in 4, that are going to be burned for fuel. So now there's going to be a time where the nation will start to thrive again. They will have security again. They will have abundance again. And all of this, and this is important, will be regulated, that something that they could not do is something that only the Lord could do. So this should be a vehicle to increase their faith. When we look at verse 4, for the yoke of his burden and the staff up for his shoulder, the rod of oppression, or the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as in the day of Midian. Now, how does the Lord do this for his people? He's going to free them from their enemies of Assyria here, who have boasted really about placing a yoke on their neck, on the people that they have conquered. Now, this was not an unusual device. When people have been conquered, they would want to humiliate the people that they have conquered even the more. Now, you recognize a yoke is that heavy harness that you would put on an animal or oxen so you can control their flow. And here it had been prophesied that Israel's enemies wanted to put a yoke upon them. But the Assyrian army here doesn't have the ability to do it. And again, when I tell you that God wants to show them that he is their victor, it's kind of like, if you remember, what is it, Judges chapter 6 and 7, when you have Gideon, and Gideon starts off with like 10,000, and the Lord brings his army down to 300, so that it is known by the whole world that they could have never conquered their enemies on their own. This is something that the Lord would do for them. The same process or same concept is happening here. The Lord is going to do something so incredible for them by conquering their enemies that no one around them would ever think that the Lord wasn't on their side when this happens. Isaiah 5 starts to talk about this conquering. Every boot of the trampling warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in the blood will be burned as fuel for fire. So here we go. Isaiah says that the oppressor will not oppress anymore. His very devices of war are going to be destroyed. This echoes really of, what is it, chapter 2 in Isaiah chapter 2, verse 4. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. I guess to put it more plainly here, the Lord is the reigning king of the earth. He's the only one that can bring lasting peace, and he's going to do it. He's going to secure the land. He's going to make Israel thrive again without fear of their enemies, because he is their conquering warrior, okay?
And when is this going to be? What year?
This all comes as this is all predicated on the light that is coming, which we start to see in verse 6. But then again, remember, he's speaking in past tense, but this is a future thing. So this doesn't happen until Christ comes.
So you think, so verse 6 is kind of the answer to my question of when. Maybe that flows really well. Maybe people are wondering just exactly, Isaiah, what are you saying? What year right. is he coming? Okay, oh. and of course, did he do all these things in year zero?
I would say this is a dual prophecy, because God does some of it, but this is really, 6 is going to really speak to the fact of it comes because of the Messiah. This child is born. And even if you think about that from a Jew, now think about this, Neil, from a Jewish perspective, the Jews, an Orthodox Jew, even today at Passover sets his table with an empty chair looking for Elijah, because the Messiah can't come till Elijah comes. So from that perspective, this still hasn't happened. Only a Messianic Jew would understand that if you can bear it, Elijah came in the form of John the Baptist. And then now they accept Jesus Christ as the Messiah, knowing that Elijah has come, and all of these titles that this child is being given in verse 6 will come to fruition. Look at verse 6 for a moment. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. So this verse starts to describe how God is going to accomplish this. He's going to do it through a person. He's going to do it through a human person that is being born through the womb of a woman, and that is also totally divine. Many people take this as a modern Christians as a Christmas verse because it predicts the birth of Jesus, the hope for salvation for all people. But really, this is the promise of God to Israel as a deliverer, that this is the one that is their Messiah, that's going to restore their glory, the joy to their nation, that's going to increase their population, and that this child will become king of Israel as well as king of all the world. Yes.
Well, okay, so yeah, we see this son is born. This isn't the first time in the book of Isaiah that we hear this kind of language. And previous times may have had a dual application about something pretty immediate, that Isaiah himself was going to have a son, or a young woman who was going to have a son. So talk about that. Does this one have any kind of immediate application in addition to ultimately being Christ and very ultimately being his eternal reign?
Well, I think the immediate application comes through the hope and that it generates, the comfort that it gives those who actually believe in God and who are going to follow this, because even being born as a child, there's still going to be a lengthy time before this person reaches adulthood. But again, I think the immediacy comes in the promise of the child is being born and that the deliverer is on his way. Now, a specific timeline or a date, I don't think Isaiah had a clue, and they most definitely didn't. But again, if you are being, you've been in darkness and anguish, and you've been invaded by a foreign nation, you look for these signs that are going to lead you out of that anguish. So this comes as that light that's going to escalate their departure. Now, again, not on a timeline, but that it will happen. And they try to show, at least I think Isaiah is trying to show here, that this is not just any ordinary child, that he states that the government will be on his shoulders. Now, it's not unusual for kings to be given lavish titles, but look at the way this starts off, that he's going to be the crown prince, especially empowered agent of God. I mean, Isaiah leaves no room that this child is going to be, look, wonderful counselor. That describes a wonderful monarch that has the ability of kingly wisdom, kind of like Solomon, a leader that's going to always make the best decisions in every scenario for the people that are his subjects. But now he's called not just wonderful counselor, he's called mighty God. Now this brings on the deity of this child. And that, you know, I've seen it in some bad translations, this mighty God reduced to great hero. But Isaiah clearly means that he's a deliverer of Israel, and ultimately the deliverer of the whole world, and that his name is Christ Jesus. Then it goes, what? Everlasting Father and the Prince of Peace. Kings have been referred to as fathers of the nation for years, but the thing that's different here, especially when we get into 7, we're talking about a father whose fatherhood will never end. He's going to continue to be a father to one generation after one generation. A generation is 100 years, so forever. Now, this king is going to be a prince of peace. He's going to rule over Israel, and he's going to end this bloody war. And he's going to bring an everlasting peace on earth. I mean, even though right now we're in great turmoil, war in Ukraine, a war on the Gaza Strip, challenges from Iraq, Iran, challenges from China. But guess what? Still, there is peace in the world in so many other regions, even though we just had a major incident in Maine. There's peace in Karma Clay today. So he is still, he's Prince of Peace, even while all of these things are going on. So he is still the fulfillment of these titles he's given. Look at the verse 7. On the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do that. Make no mistake, this is not a mere mortal. This is not an ordinary child that's being born here. He comes and he will occupy the throne of David from the house of David. He will be a king of Israel forever. This is an eternal being, Christ Jesus. He's a coming king, and he will never be corrupt. He will always make perfect decisions for his people. Now his people need to adhere to those decisions and those directions. And he will bring great enthusiasm for those who trust him and trust his plan and operate within the center of his will and his power. Now, it's clearer to us than it was to the Israelites at this time that this coming king is Christ Jesus, that this coming king will be born of a virgin of Mary, that he will be called the Son of the Most High, that he will sit on the throne of David, and he will be over the house of Jacob forever, and that in his kingdom there will be no end. Look at the Luke 1:31-33. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end.
You know, on verse 7, this verse always blows me away because, you know, we see so many are seeking man's government, man's things. Man, it's all about man. And they try to kick God out. They don't even think, you know, thy kingdom come. They're thinking, you know, man's kingdom come. And then it says there will be increase. So, you know, obviously in God's way of thing, it is increasing. God's government is increasing, and we don't see it. What we see is, you know, Maine, people killing each other and injustice, you know, or wars, you know, in all around the world. And, but I know by faith, God, it's increasing. And just a simple prayer, our Father who art in heaven, thy kingdom come, the coming of the kingdom with increase. And it'll increase, you know, forever.
So, yeah. Yeah. Amen. And again, I'm reminded back when we talked in Isaiah 5 about the vineyard, again, rehearsing, the vineyard was going to be taken away from the tenants who were not providing just and righteous fruits. And in the New Testament, Jesus said it's going to be turned over to those who will provide justice and righteousness, will produce good fruits and give it to the owner rightfully. Which not only started in Jesus' time himself, you know, as he modeled healing and self-sacrifice on our behalf, but then turned it over to the church. And it was the first occasion where in the scriptures where it says there were no poor among them in that early Jerusalem church. They'd been charged with that mandate back in Deuteronomy, as I remember it, but it was never seemingly fulfilled. It was never mentioned that it was fulfilled, even in the early good days of the kingdom, the small kingdom in Israel. So yeah, I'm with Holly. It's an overcoming church. Yeah. I think Revelation 7 or 2 and 3, as it describes the seven churches, it's pretty darn clear that it's overcoming church. Even though, Maine, this Israel, Gaza, that Ukraine and so forth, on the whole, you know, his righteousness will come to pass. Yeah. As you pointed out, Andy, it's in the past tense. It's authoritative. It's a done deal.
You know, the Bible, when you said, you know, there were to be no poor, Jesus, you know, it always has tension. Jesus said the poor will always be among you. You know, so, but it's that tension. No. Yeah.
He didn't say that to the church. He didn't say that to the children of God. I think he was preaching to the general populace, and that wasn't his point in that verse anyway. His point in that verse was, you want to do good, you're always going to have poor that you can do good to. So, but the Acts portion where it said there was no poverty among them, was the body of Jesus, right? Am I right or wrong?
Yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong.
Okay,
fair enough. That's what we see, a picture of the beloved society in Acts. We don't see many places where they all had the common, basically, I'm paraphrasing, the common need met. That everyone that was in that group of believers had all of their needs met, because again, we were dealing with the one anotherings, you know, the over 70 one anotherings in the Bible, that we were praying for one another, helping one another, there we were feeding and meeting the needs of one another, because when one person was in plenty and another person was in lack, we shared and we had all things in common.
Yeah. So Andy, I know you said you had to cut things off a little early today so you could get away to meetings and so forth. But I did want, you know, I'm like, hey, the first time we would have heard this from Isaiah, man, I would have thought, when that Messiah comes, that's it. He's going to, the government will be on his shoulders. He's going to do all this stuff. Bam. Just like that. So I'm not surprised, I guess, at, you know, Jews in Jesus's time thinking, all right. Is this it? Right. Is this when you're going to establish the kingdom?
No. And I would agree totally. That is exactly the mindset and the overview they had, and that probably yielded some of their disappointment in Jesus. I mean, you're looking for Arnold Schwarzenegger and you get Barney Fife, and you know, they're very disappointed. No, when is this going to happen? But again, Jesus shows them there's a different, he's going to accomplish this in a different way.
Yeah, that already not yet thing, you know, it eventually hit me that, you know what, that started really, really early. And right after creation, God said, okay, in the day you eat of that fruit, you're going to die. And they didn't seemingly die that day, right? So we're like, okay, what is he telling? And so our hermeneutic, I guess, is what I'm saying, needs right. to be on the lookout for a better understanding of what his timeline is. Anyway, good morning, died. Chaplain Lopez.
How you doing?
Yeah.
They died because they lost the covering of God. That's why once they ate of that tree, they were convinced through guilt that they were naked because they no longer had the covering of God.
Yeah. All right. Well, Andy, as we often say, it's Friday at Clay Terrace. These seven verses we've read and the others mentioned, how does this apply? What do I do today with this?
Well, regardless of what our present condition is, we can believe and bank on the hope that God has made that he will deliver us, regardless of the doom and gloom that we might find ourselves in, that there has been a light that has been shown upon us, and that we should, you know, as they tell you, go to the light. We should go to the light because that's where the promise is, and that's where the comfort and the security is in the center of his will, because he's the light of the world. He will bring us out of darkness into his marvelous light.
Awesome. Any other comments and or questions, Holly or Neff? Sorry, Neff, you just got in, but yeah, we've been discussing the mighty passage here in Isaiah 9, you know, and it hasn't been mentioned yet. A lot of this poetic language is used in the great concert, the Messiah, right? And so it's profound, and it's always been understood as being really profound. Yeah, so that's good. Well, Hayden, who would pray for us as we adjourn? Oh, Holly, thank you.
Oh. Father in heaven, your kingdom come. Just your government have no end in us, Lord. Let us, like Andy said, go to the light and cling to you in all that we do. Let our light so shine that we truly bring the kingdom to this earth. And we surrender all to you. Know that you are the good shepherd, and know that you have empowered us to go through our day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen.